as far as the industrial controllers are concerned. So we are going to talk about industrial controllers. And just as we have said, the industrial controllers are going to be, they are always how this particular system is going to restore, so that whenever there is a change, whenever there is a change in the input, whenever there is a change in the input, how is it going to ensure that this particular change in the input brings about that particular controlled variable so that it is as close as possible to the reference input or the set point. So you can say, the basic characteristic of a controller, is the way it acts. The basic characteristic of a controller is the way it acts to restore the controlled variable to its desired value. Full stop. The different control actions are called modes of control. So how this one is going to restore, how that particular controller is going to restore, is what determines the modes of controller. And in this case, we are going to talk about different modes of control. And the common modes of control, you can say the common modes of control include, one of them is, number one, we can talk of the two position. Number two, we can talk of floating control. Number three, we can talk of the proportional control. Then we can talk about the integral control. The integral control can also always be, we can also call that one reset. And finally, we can talk about the derivative. The derivative control, which we can always refer to as rate or preact. So these ones are the control modes that we are going to talk about one by one, starting with the two position. And we are going to look at what do we talk about the mode of control when you talk of the two position. Then we are going to talk of the proportional. Then floating, proportional, integral, and derivative. And of course, we are going to talk about the combination, because you'll find that each and every mode of control always has got a disadvantage. And that is why it is not always advisable to use, like when you talk of the proportional is not always advised that you use it alone, because it is not going to eliminate the offset. When you come to the integral may not be used alone, because it is going to bring about the oscillation. Then the derivative will not also be used alone, because it is going to bring about, it has got an infinite output when a step input is given to it. So basically, those ones are the modes of control. So we are going to start by looking at the first one, which is the two-position control. And this is the most common one. Kama pasi. Yeah? We talk about the iron box. So ukipiga pasi hivi after umeset, kuna pasi zingine zimewekwa in such a way that unaweza weka the material, the material type. Zingine zimeandikwa cotton, polyester and the rest. Sindio? Ukisha turn, after turning that, uweke at the appropriate point. Itakuwa ikizima, ikienda. Sindio? Yeah? It goes on, off, on, off. Which means it is now, that is now what we are referring to as two position. Or you can also talk about the air conditioner, sindio? Yeah? Unaweka air conditioner, it comes on when the temperature rises. Then after some time, when the temperatures go, the temperature comes down, ina inaenda off, sindio? The same with the refrigerator, sindio? Yeah, the refrigerator, kuna wakati unasikia inanguruma, inanguruma, then all of a sudden, inaachana. So that is now the two position. It only has on-off position, huh? Are we together? It only has on-off position. So that is now what we are talking about as far as the two position is concerned. So when you talk of the two position, you can say two position control, you say. This is the simplest and the most common mode of control. This is the simplest and the most common mode of control. This is the simplest and the most common mode of control. Full stop. The controller output has two possible values. The controller output has two possible values. Depending on the sign of the error. The controller output has two possible values depending on the sign of the error. The controller output has two possible values depending on the sign of the error. So that is now what we have said. Inaenda off, inaenda on. And when you come to the control now, it will be dependent on the sign of the error. At times, the temperature may have gone up. Maybe you are trying to control a certain average temperature. It may have gone up. Maybe the difference is negative or the difference is positive. And now that is now what we are talking about as determining the sign of the error. So you can say the input-output curve of a two-position controller is as shown below. The input-output curve of a two-position. The input-output curve of a two-position controller is as shown below. So this is now the input-output curve of a two-position controller, whereby here we have, we can talk of it in terms of percentage. We have 100, then we have the controller output in percentage. Controller output, and that one should be in percentage. Then at this point, we can have that. So this is where we usually refer to as the neutral zone, and it is simply the areas around zero that the error must pass before any control action can take place. So those are some of the definitions that you can be asked, and some of them that we had talked about earlier before. I'm also going to give you some further definitions that you should also be very, very much aware of, because they are very, very common. So we have the error. So that is the controller output in percentage. Then we have the neutral zone. Then that is now what the input-output curve of a two-position control. That is now the input-output curve of a two-position control as far as the industrial controllers are concerned. So as we have said, this one is always very, very cyclic, because you look at it, turning on, turning off, turning on, turning off. So if you look at the graph, it is cyclic, because it is going to be on, off in that particular order. And therefore, that one makes it to be not very much commonly used in most of the cases. And unless you have the processes that have got high capacitance, that are even large enough in order to counteract the effect of this particular daytime lag and the load change capability, because that particular cycling is going to bring about, it is the simplest, but it is not the best. Sawa sawa? Yeah, it is the simplest, mode of control, but it's not the best. So that is now what we can talk about as far as the two position is concerned. Can say, you say the neutral zone is a set of values. The neutral zone is a set of values around zero. The neutral zone is a set of values around zero, which the error must pass through. Which the error must pass through before any control action takes place. So looking at that, this is now the neutral zone. You can see that there is the side where we have the negative sign of the error and the positive sign of the error. So before that neutral zone, before the error is able to pass through the neutral zone, then there will be no any control action that can take place. So that is now what we can say as far as the input-output curve of the two-position control mode is concerned. So you say two-position control supplies energy in pulses to the process. Two-position control supplies energy in pulses to the process. It supplies energy in pulses to the process, just as we had said, because it is going to be on off. So it is going to bring the cyclic nature, and that is why we are referring to it as supplying the pulses. It's supplying energy in pulses to the process. You can say this causes a cycling of the controlled variable. This causes the cycling of the control variable. This causes the cycling of the control variable. The amplitude of the cycling depends on three factors. So the factors that it is depending on, one of them is the capacitance of the process. Depending on three factors. So one, the capacitance of the process. Two, dead time lag of the process. And finally, the size of the load changes the process is capable of handling. Load changes that the process is capable of handling. So these are the three factors that will always determine the cycling, the amplitude of the cycling of the two position control. So you'll find that when that one happens, then the amplitude of the oscillation will always, we can either decrease it by increasing the capacitance and then decreasing the daytime lag, or decreasing the size of the load. But you must always try as much as possible to strike a balance so that the control action that you are going to obtain from that is to what is required. So you say the amplitude of the oscillation is decreased By either increasing the capacitance, decreasing the dead time, or decreasing the size of the load. For these reasons, Two position control is only used in processes that have a capacitance. For these reasons, two position control. For these reasons, comma, two position controls is only used in processes that have a capacitance large enough. To counteract the combined effect of the daytime lag. The combined effect of the daytime lag and the load change capability. So that is the reason why you'll find that in most cases we don't usually use the two position, especially when you need to carry out we need a controller that is needed for a little bit complicated control system, because in that nature it is only going to control it by on off, and in that case it is going to be cyclic, and therefore when you have a system that does not have large capacitance, it is not able to store a large amount of energy by itself, then you'll find that this particular mode of control is not going to be very much applicable. You can say two position control is simple, cheap, and is preferred. Two position control is simple, cheap, and preferred whenever the cycling can be reduced to an acceptable level, and is preferred whenever the cycling can be reduced to an acceptable level. For example, switching on and off a heat supply. With switching in both directions occurring at the same time, at the same preset temperature. Occurring at the same preset temperature. So that one now we can have. So that is now how we can show how cyclic in nature it is going to be. So you find that in that case, you can have it there in that manner. So we can have that where these ones are the switching points. So these ones are the controller switching points. Yes? So these ones are the controller switching points. So we can talk of the controller switching points. Then from there, we can have, this is now an aspect of time. Then this one will give us the desired value. We have the desired value there. Then, of course, at this point, we can also have, so this one can be the load temperature. We can talk of that one to be the load temperature. Then heat supply to the load. We can have the heat supply to the load. So in that case, we have that. Have the heat supplied in that manner, then there in that manner. So that one shows So that switching on and off, this one now is switching on and off. Switching on and off a heat supply. Switching on and off a heat supply. So that is now generally what we can have as far as this particular method is concerned, this particular mode of control. So you'll find that when you talk of this mode of control, another way of improving it is whereby you can have switches placed at several points so that you can have a switch in between, so that you can have an overlap. Before it goes off, another one comes. We have an overlap. Before it goes off completely, then the other one has come on, so that, because in this case, if it is going to be on, off, then of course you'll find that there will be even a problem. There will be a problem in terms of wear and tear for that particular switching operation, the switching device. So it may not have, it may not live for long. In Ezaribi Karaka. So in that case, you'll find that at times we can have several switching points so that we develop an overlap for that particular system. So that is now what we can say as far as that one is concerned. And this is now the nature. You remember we say that it is cyclic. So it is going on, off, whereby at that point we can talk of heat cooling, can have, so we have cooling, then at that point we can talk of it as having heating. So that is now how that particular controller will work. See, the magnitude and the frequency of the temperature cycling, the magnitude and the frequency of temperature cycling will depend upon the magnitude and the frequency of the temperature cycling will depend upon the magnitude and the frequency of cycling will depend upon the magnitude of the heat source. Will depend upon the magnitude of the heat source, and the dynamics of the thermal load will depend upon the magnitude of the heat source and the dynamics of the dynamics of the thermal load. In most controllers, it is found that the correcting element, in most controllers, it is found that the correcting element is not moved until the temperature has actually, is not moved until the temperature has actually passed the desired value. Until the temperature has actually passed the desired value. And thus, until the temperature has actually passed the desired value. And thus, the controller may be designed with an adjustable overlap. And thus, the controller may be designed with an adjustable overlap. So that the two predetermined control actions are alternated when the controlled condition are alternated when the controlled condition passes from one to the other of the chosen two values. Just passes from one to the other of the two chosen values, as shown. So in this case, we just have to adjust so that we develop an overlap. And that one is going to eliminate that particular cycling, switching on and off, very much as far as that is concerned. So we can have an overlap. We can show how the overlap works. So when you talk of this, then generally what we are simply talking about saying is that we can have that, in that case, and we can have the switching position to be here, that manner. So that we can have the potential value here. Can call that point A. So here we have the potential value. Then at this point we have the desired value. We can call this one, this line here, we can call it desired value. Then here at this point now we have the overlap. Then of course this point we can say to be ABCD, the switching points. So we have the overlap. So that is now the controller with adjustable overlap. So you can see that in this case the switching points have now shifted, such that in this case before, at that point we will have the switching, it will not take time. So this one is actually going to reduce that particular deviation, and it is going to make the switching device, be it a contactor or rather that particular correcting unit, it will have a longer life for that particular equipment that is used for the switching device. So that is now controller, two position controller with adjustable overlap. So this is two position controller with adjustable overlap. So that is now what we can talk about as far as two position is concerned. So you'll find that if this particular width, the width of the overlap is increased, then the frequency of the oscillation will always be decreased, but the amplitude will increase. So maybe we can note that. If the width of the overlap is so increased, the frequency of oscillation is decreased, but the amplitude is increased. The frequency of oscillation is decreased, but the amplitude is increased. But the amplitude is increased. Full stop. If this greater deviation from the desired value can be prevented, the less frequent operation of the valve or contactor, or other correcting unit means, a longer life for the equipment, or other correcting unit means a longer life for the equipment, or other correcting unit means a longer life for the equipment. So basically what we are simply saying is that the introduction of several switching points where we were trying to improve the on-off or to position control mode, that introduction of several points is going to bring about an overlap. The overlap is going to ensure that this particular system is not now going to have several on-off. And when that one happens, then it means that it is going to make whatever the correcting device that has been used, be it the contactor that has been used, or be it the solenoid valve or any other type of valve that has been used, then it is not going to be on off several times. And that one will actually mean that that particular equipment is going to live longer. Are we together? So that is what we are saying. I think that is much as far as the two position is concerned. The next one, we are simply going to talk about floating control. And under the floating control, the floating control is simply a special application of the two position control, in which the final control element is going to be stationary as long as the error remains within the neutral zone. But when it goes up outside the neutral zone, then what it means is that it is going to go to the extreme ends. Either when you are talking of a valve, it is going to be either fully shut or fully open. Are we together? So we can talk of floating control, yes?
I think when you're talking about the two position again, an example was to say for an iron box, where it is either off or on. And you're talking of controlling some temperature. Maybe say the set value is, you want 60 degrees. And okay, now you don't want it to cycle. Maybe you say, I don't know, if it was 60, you say maybe if it goes to 55, it switches on. It goes to 65, it switches off. Okay, now you're going to the floating one. Again, you say the valve is either shut or not shut. I'm confused, I don't know the difference now.
The other one, if you look at the input output, in fact, we have not talked about floating. I was just introducing it. But if you look at the other one, we could see from the input output curve, the graph was such that there was the neutral zone. Then we said that in the neutral zone, the error must pass the neutral zone before any control action takes place. But when you talk about the floating, what it simply means that it will remain in the neutral zone. But if it goes beyond, then it goes to the extreme ends. Either it is going to be fully shut or fully open. So we are talking about either, like in the case of the milk pasteurization plant, it is not going to open proportionally according to the amount of energy that, according to the amount of heat that is needed. If it goes past the neutral zone, it is going to open the whole of the pipe so that the steam gets inside. If it goes below, it is going to be fully shut. So it is just another way of control. Sawa. We are talking of modes of control. How is it going to happen? So you can talk about floating control. Floating control. So when you talk about floating control, you say this is a special application. Floating control. This is a special application of two position control. This is a special application of two position control. This is a special application of two position control in which the final control element, two position control, in which the final control element is stationary. In which the final control element is stationary as long as the error is stationary, as long as the error remains. Is stationary as long as the error remains within the neutral zone. Is stationary as long as the error remains within the neutral zone. However, when the controlled variable is outside the neutral zone, when the controlled variable is outside the neutral zone, the final control element changes. The final control element changes at a constant rate in the direction determined by the error. The final control element changes at a constant rate in a direction determined by the sign of the error. Changes at a constant rate in the direction determined by the sign of the error. The final control element continues to change. The final control element continues to change until the error returns to the neutral zone. Until the error returns to the neutral zone. Or until one of its extreme positions. Or until the final control element, or until the final control element, or until the final control element reaches, or until the final control element reaches one of its extreme positions, reaches one of its extreme positions. The input-output curve is as shown. The input-output curve is as shown. So we are talking about the floating control. The input-output curve is as shown. The input-output curve is as shown. So we talk about the floating control. So when you talk about this, then the input-output curve, we are going to have, this one is now what we have. This side, we are going to have the final control element speed. So here, final control element speed. And now the final control element speed. Maybe here, we have the zero. So at this point, we can have that. And here. Then there. So our neutral zone is going to be here. So here we have neutral zone. Then here we have the error plus minus zero minus plus. And this one here we have the error. So you can see when it is within the neutral zone, it does not change. But as long as it is outside the neutral zone, it is changing at a constant rate. Sawa-sawa, depending on the sign of the error. If the sign of the error is negative, then it changes at a constant rate downwards. If the sign of error is positive, it changes at the constant rate upwards. Until it gets back either to the neutral zone or until it gets to the extreme positions. So when you're talking of a valve, it is either going to be fully shut or fully open. The other case, you could see that it was at a point, there was no change taking place in the neutral zone. When it gets past the neutral zone, then it was now changing in the other, but not at a constant rate compared to this. So you can see that particular difference in the graph. So that is the graphical representation. So this is just the output curve of a floating controller, float controller. Is it float or floating? Again, because we are talking about this particular type of control to be a special type of on-off, or rather two position, then again, just like the other, that is the two position, it has got that tendency to produce cycling. It has got that particular tendency to produce cycling. And then the amplitude of the cycling, again, just like the other one, will always be depending on the daytime lag of the process, the capacitance, as well as the speed at which the controller is going to increase or decrease the final control element. So those are some of the things that will be considered. The main advantage of having this particular floating control is just its ability to handle large load changes. So it is able to handle large load changes compared to the floating controller, because it is just gradually it will be gradually adjusting to the final control element, just gradually. So that is now how that one is different.
When you now talk of a neutral zone, for it to become a zone, does it mean that now that the set point is a range of values? It is not a constant value.
Yeah, it's going to be a range of values. It's going to be a range of values. That is why you'll find that when we are talking about the control, we are talking about the overlap. So we are trying to ensure that we are not now talking about maybe 60 degrees Celsius, but it has to be within some particular values. So it is going to be a range of values. So as long as it is within that range of values, there is no control action that is going to take place. But if it moves outside those values, then of course there has to be a control action in order to take it back to the neutral zone, because that is where we are considering that the set point is found. Sawa-sawa. You say floating control has the tendency to produce. Floating control has the tendency to produce cycling. Floating control has the tendency to produce cycling of the controlled variable. Has the tendency to produce cycling of the controlled variable. Full stop. Has the tendency to produce cycling of the controlled variable. Full stop. The amplitude of the cycling depending on the speed. The amplitude of the cycling depending on the speed. The amplitude of the, no, not speed, but depending on the dead time lag. Depending on the dead time lag. Depending on the dead time lag. The amplitude of the cycling depending on the dead time lag of the process. On the dead time lag of the process. And you remember what we said about the dead time lag of the process, comma, the capacitance of the process, the capacitance of the process, the capacitance of the process, and the speed at which the controller increases, and the speed at which the controller increases and decreases, and the speed at which the controller increases and decreases, the final control element, and the speed at which the controller increases and decreases, the final control element, increases and decreases, the final control element. Floating control is used when large load changes are anticipated. Floating control is used when large load changes are anticipated. When large load changes are anticipated. And the capacitance is large enough. Are anticipated, and the capacitance is large enough to counteract the effects. And the capacitance is large enough to counteract the effects of the dead time lag, of the dead time lag, the effects of the dead time lag, the effects of the dead time lag, and the speed of the final control element. 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 So that is now what the floating control is all about. I think we can talk about the proportional control. The capacitance, we say that is the amount of heat that is going to be absorbed. We gave an example of heating the water. The water will not rise immediately because it is going to absorb energy. So that energy that is stored in water is what we refer to as the capacitance. It is not the capacitance per se, the electrical capacitance that you know. Sawa sawa. But we are talking about the thermal capacitance. That ability to store quantity of heat. That ability of that particular what is supposed to be controlled to store some heat, absorb some before that change is effected. You remember when we were introducing this, the capacitance came under process lag. Yeah, and we say that the process lag is the difference in time between which a manipulated variable is applied or a control agent is applied and the time of which the effect will be seen. So when you talk of the capacitance, a good example, you are heating water. When you apply heat, the water is going to absorb some heat energy. Yeah, that aspect of absorbing the heat energy is now what we are referring to as the capacitance. Yeah, when you talk of the resistance, then that particular heat, there is losses. It is going to be absorbed by whatever you are going to heat. It is not 100%. It's going to be absorbed fast. So after that is when you see the difference. And when you talk of the dead time, when we are talking about the difference in time, now it is the aspect of time, the dead time or the transportation. So those ones, that is how they contribute to the lag. So we are not simply talking about the capacitance that we are going to measure in farads. We are simply talking about the thermal capacitance, that ability to store some energy in form of heat. Sawa sawa. Yes, that is now the difference. Yes. So we can talk about proportional control. Proportional control. So when you talk about the proportional control, then remember, when I was introducing the modes of control, I did say that the modes of control are simply how the controller is trying to restore. How is it going to restore that particular output so that it is as close as possible to the reference input? Are we together? Yeah? Are we together? And when you talk of the controller, the input of the controller from the block diagram of the control system, let's just get back to the block diagram of the control system. We usually have the controller at this point. Then here, we have the actuator. Then we have the process plant. If maybe we can have what we are talking about here. Then of course, here we can have the sensor, or we can talk of the, so that is now what we are saying. And in that case here, we usually have R of S. And yo, then here we have the C of S. The R of S is now the reference input. So our interest is here. Yeah? Of which, if you look at the controller, then the input is always the error. Are we together? So what the controller is trying to manipulate is the error. Yes? The difference that is going to be between C of S and R of S. That difference, it is always given by, at times after conversion, we usually talk of it as B of S. Are we together? So that they are brought to the same level and the same dimension. So that difference is what we have. So in a sense, when you're talking about the controller, whether you are talking of the two position, whether you are talking about the proportional, whether you are talking about the integral, maybe later on, then we must know that what is supposed to be manipulated is the error, because that is the input that is going to get into the controller. So how the controller is going to control this, is going to manipulate this error in order to restore in order to ensure that the difference between this and that is as small as possible, especially with the reference with the regulatory systems, then that is now what we are talking about as the controller. So when you talk about the proportional control, then the proportional control, the output we can talk of, because the output now is going to be electrical quantity, it is going to be V. So that particular output, V, it is going to be equals to, for it to be proportional, so it is going, a proportional control is going to give an output that is directly proportional to the error. Are we together? So that V, which is now the output of the controller, is going to be given by KE. Yeah? And maybe plus the initial condition. Are we together? So that is now what the proportional control is all about. So it is going to produce a change in the controller. It is going to give a change in the controller that has got, that is going to give a controller output that is proportional to the error signal. And that is what we are saying there. So you can say proportional control. You say proportional control. Proportional control. Proportional control produces. Proportional control produces. Proportional control produces a change in the controller output. Produces a change in the controller output. Produces a change in the controller output. Proportional to the error signal. Proportional to the error signal. Full stop. There is a fixed relationship between the values of the control element. There is a fixed relationship. There is a fixed relationship. There is a fixed relationship. Between the values of the control element. Between the values of the control element. Between the values of the control element. Full stop. And we did say that when I was introducing this, I did say that some of these control modes of control, they cannot be used alone. As I did say, the proportional control has got its own problem whereby it is not able to eliminate the offset. Because it is proportional, if there was something that was there before, it turns a two up or you. So it is now going to just to be proportional from that particular point where it has started. So it is not going to eliminate whatever was existing before. That is the offset. So you can say the main disadvantage of proportional control is that the main disadvantage of the proportional control is that it cannot completely eliminate the error. Caused by a load change. That is, there is always an offset. Proportional control is used. When the gain can be made large enough. The effects of the largest load change on the proportional offset. An operational amplifier can be used. To form an electronic proportional controller. An electronic proportional controller as shown below. So the proportional controller, if we represent it in terms of op-amp, then what we are going to have, something like that, whereby the input we can have RF, then going to that, in that manner, then here we can have R, not, we can call that one R1, we can call this one R1, then here we can call it RF, then we can have an op-amp, then there, in that manner, so that the input of the controller, so that is now the controller, the input is the error, and the output we can have it to be in electrical, and that is now what we call V as the output. Then we can now look at now the time domain equation, the frequency domain equation, and all that, so that we are able to finalize on that. So from there, we can talk of the time domain equation. As we have said, that in the time domain equation, this one is going to give an output that is directly proportional to the error. Therefore, small v is going to be equal to Ke plus V naught. We can get the frequency domain equation by getting the Laplace transform of that, and the Laplace transform is always found when you assume that the condition is relaxed. And when the condition is relaxed, then what it means is that the initial condition is zero, and therefore it means that the V naught is not going to be there. Yeah, therefore we can get the frequency domain equation. So the frequency domain equation, capital V now is going to be equals to Ke. Then after that, we can now go to the transfer function, TF, TF will be given by output over input. What is the output? V, sindio? And what is the input? E. Therefore, the transfer function will simply be V all over E, which is also going to give us K. So those are some of the equations that we are going to have. Maybe what remains, we can now define what we have used there so that we can know the difference. And mostly the difference is always in terms of the domain. You find that if I write small v means that it is in time domain equation. Capital V means that it is in frequency domain equation for all that. So where we can talk of where V, small v, is the time domain output signal. So that is the time domain output signal. We can talk of capital V. No, we can talk of V naught first. V naught is the time domain output signal at E is equals to zero. Time domain output signal at E is equals to zero. Then we can talk of capital V where we talk of frequency domain output. Frequency domain, we can call it deviation, output deviation, or signal output deviation. Frequency domain output deviation. Then we can have small e. When it is small, that is time domain, so that is the error. That is the time domain error signal. So that is now going to be time domain error signal. We can talk of time domain error signal in that respect. Then we can talk of capital E. Capital E, the capital E is going to be the frequency domain error signal. So that is going to be frequency domain error signal. We can talk of the frequency domain error signal. Then we can talk of K, which is now going to be given by, if you look at K will be given by the output resistance over the input resistance, which is going to be RF over R1. So that's how. So K is RF all over R1. RF all over R1. And then where RF is, we can just use that. RF is the output resistance. Output resistance in ohms. And R1 is the input resistance also. Also in ohms. So that is now what we have. So that one defines everything that we've talked about as far as this one is concerned. So that is now the electronic presentation of the proportional control. And these ones are now what you use in order to carry out an analysis. And maybe with that, we can do a small example. And then I think we will stop at that point. Example. Example. An electronic proportional controller uses a value of 10 raised to the power 4 ohms. An electronic proportional controller uses a value of 10 raised to the power 4 ohms for output resistor RF. Uses a value of 10 raised to the power 4 ohms for output resistor RF. For output resistor RF. Full stop. Determine the value of R1 for a gain of 0.2. Determine the value of R1 for a gain of 0.2. determine the value of R1 for a gain of 0.2. Determine the value of R1 for a gain of 0.2. That one is something that you should have finished. Eh? Yeah? Is that true? That one is something that you should have finished. Eh? So what is the answer? Division of labor. Hmm? What's the answer? Fifty kilos. I think that is what is there. I think what remains in proportional control is something on proportional band. I don't know who is going to